All right, good afternoon, guys. Hope everyone had a good lunch. Welcome to my session today on web content management in SharePoint 2013. So a few bit of housekeeping before we get started. So this is level 200 paper, which means that we're not going to get too hardcore, but I'm expecting a little bit of SharePoint knowledge prior. Ideally, you've played around with 2010. If this isn't what you're expecting, feel free to leave right now. I promise I won't hold it against you. My name is Jacques. I'm the development manager at Provoke Solutions. We specialise in creating SharePoint, Azure, and bespoke solutions, both in New Zealand and around the world. So that's enough about me. Let's get cracking on a presentation. Okay, so let me cover off the world's shortest agenda. So today, I'm going to give you a quick overview on some of the new functionality in terms of web content management with SharePoint 2013, some stuff that I think is really cool. And then we're going to jump straight into a bunch of demos and a semi-real-world scenario, and I'm going to show you some of this really cool stuff in action. Okay, so what's new in 2013 for web content management? So firstly, in terms of UI, we're all HTML5 now. We've got a great new interface. It's really easy to use. It's really responsive. Because it's HTML5, it means we can support a bunch of new browsers. We can leverage video inside the browser as well and support a bunch of different more devices as well, which is pretty cool. Search is pretty massive in 2013 as well, right? We've got now 2013, they've incorporated FAST from 2010, which means we can do some pretty cool things around moving content from one site collection to another, and we'll run to some demos around that later. In terms of social, big social framework, and now we also have the integration with Yammer, which really can help drive user adoption and user engagement with the product. Hopefully you saw Debbie's presentation before with a bit more information around that. Next thing, from a hosting option, we've got pretty flexible choices around how we deploy our solutions nowadays. So we can go on traditional on-premise solution. We've also got 365. And now, as you saw in Scott's demo, we've also got VMs in Azure. We can also deploy on-premise solutions in the cloud, which is pretty powerful and pretty cool. And the best thing of all of this is in 2013, we no longer have an internet connector license. So if you already own a SharePoint license internally, there's no excuse not to go check out a public web as well, to go do it. And then last thing, from a developer perspective, we've got a really awesome, flexible approach to how we deliver our solutions. We're no longer tightly coupled with SharePoint Designer. We can, as a branding integrator, I can use whatever tools I'm familiar with, Dreamweaver, TextPad, whatever, to create my branding artifacts. And with the app framework, I can leverage other languages and existing skills to deliver solutions and components to SharePoint Intranet or public website without even having to know C#. Not sure why you want to do that, but you can if you want to. Okay, and the bits in red over here, we're going to look at in a bit more detail during this demonstration. Okay, so that's 2-second overview of some of the stuff that I think is really cool in 2013. Let's jump into our scenario. And before we get started, let me just kind of set the scene a little bit around what we're going to talk about today. So a while ago, I read an article in the Herald about the explosion of online dating websites on the internet. And I found it pretty interesting. Some pretty interesting sites out there. These are a couple of my favourites. So clown dating, websites for clowns to meet other clowns. Sea captain date, you know, where you find a captain of your dreams. And my personal favourite, mullet passions, which I can probably really associate with. Unfortunately, neither my missus or my boss let me grow a mullet, which is quite disappointing. And then personals for cat lovers as well. And you know, I'm not giving these guys a hard time, each of their own, but what this really kind of brought to light to me is something that we're really missing out in the marketplace today, and that's the SharePoint online dating website for SharePoint professionals who can find maybe some SharePoint advice and love at the same time. And I plan on changing that today. So our motto for this website is collaborate, share, and love, you know, in the spirit of SharePoint. Okay, so that's the high-level scenario, and this is what we're going to run through today. I'm going to take a blank publishing site. We're going to brand it up using the new Design Manager functionality in 2013. Then we're going to set up information architecture and pages using managed navigation. Once we've got our base content set up, I'm going to show you how we can use the product catalog to move site from a rendering site to a public website. Leveraging search. After that, we can look at some mobile support and optimise our site for multiple devices. And then last but not least, we're going to optimise our site for search engines. Cool. So a lot of stuff to cover today, and we might be breezing through a few topics, but this is only an overview. So afterwards, if any questions, I'll try and answer them. And if you've got some good questions, we'll try and give away some prizes as well. I got no idea what this thing is, but it looks freaking awesome. All right. So first up, branding. So in 2013, we've kind of got two options around how we brand up our sites. The first one is composed looks. So you can think of this composed looks pretty much like themes in 2010. Pretty basic, just reskinning our content. So you get a few out-the-box options to choose from, or you can create your own. And they're just driven from a single list on your publishing site where you specify a background image, a master page, and some SharePoint files that specify attributes and hex color values as well. And then you can go and tweak all this through the browser, pretty low investment. But in fact, all you're really doing is just reskinning out-the-box look and feel with a few different colors, which is pretty cool. But on the other hand, if you want to take it a bit further and create some really rich user experience and really cool user design, then you need to start using Design Manager, which is, again, a new piece of functionality in 2013. So this is the kind of rough workflow on how Design Manager works. So firstly, you get your designer who to draw some pretty pictures in Photoshop, whatever tool designer use nowadays. Once you've got your images and your collateral, you hand over to your integrator. So your integrator is firstly going to map their local machine to the SharePoint farm or to the master page gallery so they can interact with the different files in there. Then they use an online tool, which we'll see in a second, to generate code snippets to add to their master pages and page layouts. They'll use whatever tool they're familiar with to integrate this. So you could be using Dreamweaver. Like I said, you could be using TextPad, whatever they're comfortable with. And then we're going to package it up with one click all through the browser and then deploy to different sites. So you notice at no point in that conversation I mentioned SharePoint Designer at all. It's really easy and really low barrier to entry for people who aren't too familiar with SharePoint. Okay, so under the hood of a design package, there's quite a lot of stuff actually going on that you should be aware of. So when I extract my design package, not only am I taking my page layouts, my master pages, but it's also grabbing all the contents, or all the unique contents from my catalogs library and from my style library as well. It's even taking my property bag and display templates as well. And one thing to be aware of is that what it's going to do is take across all your content types and side columns that inherit from your publishing content types. And why this is important is that if you're actually using those same side columns in other parts of your site, in standard lists and libraries, you might run into deployment conflicts. So something to be aware of, and make sure you test that first. Okay, so that's kind of the brief overview. Let's see it in action. What I'm going to do now is jump into a demo environment and show you how I can brand up a site using Design Manager and set up a couple of pages using Managed Navigation. All right, so here I have a blank publishing site I've just created. It's using the out-the-box template. Notice it's got kind of the unique, the new 2013 look and feel. It's all very metro. And what I'm going to do now is going to open up Design Manager and have a look. So I click on Site Settings and then click on Design Manager. It'll load up my page for me in a second. So here you can see I've got some simple steps to follow to go ahead and create my content. So I'll only demo a couple of these for now. But the first thing to do is create your device channels. And I'll show that in a bit when we talk about mobile devices. But device channels let us target unique master pages for unique devices. Next, we upload all our branding collateral, so images and CSS. And we do that just through Windows Explorer. Then we create our master pages, our display templates. So display templates in 2013 is a new concept again. So in 2010, we used XLT files to style up and brand our search results and other components. In 2013, we have a new HTML and JavaScript engine that's driven from display templates. I'm not going to go into too much detail here. If you want to know more, check out Wayne's session later in the conference. But with design templates, display templates, I can tweak a lot of stuff, not just search results, but search boxes, item styles and lists, a whole bunch of stuff. And then last but not least, we create our page layouts. Once that's all done and created, we can package it up and then deploy that to a different environment. So let's have a look at what it's like to create a page layout. So I'm going to click on the page layout option over here. Okay, and it's going to open a new page. All right, and I'm going to click on create page layout. So now it gives me the option to choose a name for my page, and a content type that it's inheriting from, and the master page that it's using. So we'll call this TEN's demo page, go with Seattle master page, and inherit from the welcome page content type. So when I click OK, what SharePoint is doing in the background is going and finding what content placeholders I have on my master page, generating my page layout in the master page gallery, and getting that ready for me to start integrating. If I want to start customizing this, I have a few different steps I go through. So firstly, I'm going to open up this page over here so I can see what it looks like in preview mode. And at the same time, I'm going to jump into my file system and open up this page in a tool that I'm familiar with. So I'm just going to drag this to the side quick. Okay, so here is my master page gallery that I've mapped to a favorites in my file system previously. I'm going to go ahead and find my master page, or sorry, my page layout. Cool. Now I'll just give that a quick refresh. Cool. So here we go. So we've got our, my page layout, ASPX file, and also HTML file that you see there. So you notice they've got exactly the same name. And this comes down to the new rendering engine that we have in 2013. So the HTML page is what I edit, and we'll see how I do that in a second. And then when I save it to this gallery, event receiver kicks off behind the scene, and it converts that into ASPX page, which is loaded when the user browses to my page. So I'm going to open that up quickly. And I'm going to use Visual Studio because that's a tool that I'm familiar with as a developer. And we'll give that a few seconds. Got to love the internet speeds in New Zealand. Great, there we go. So you'll notice a brand new syntax here with HTML snippets throughout our page layout. What I'm going to do now is jump back into my SharePoint site and create some new snippets to add to this layout. Okay, so if I click on the snippets gallery in the top right-hand corner here, it takes me to a unique page that allows me to create these HTML snippets, which can then just simply copy and paste and add to my page layout. So from here, I can add any fields that are associated with my content type. It just automatically knows what this is from the previous step where I hook those two up. I can add web part zones, security trimmed areas, out-the-box web parts, whatever I like. So I'm going to go ahead and add a person contact information. So I can see a preview on what that looks like, the HTML snippets generated below, and if I wanted to, I can go through and further configure that web part or component or add attributes as I like. Once I'm happy with that, I copy that to my clipboard, take it across to Visual Studio. Okay, and I'm going to add a piece in here. And just for dramatic effect, I'll chuck a good old hello world in just to demonstrate that we are actually updating some stuff. So what's happening when I save that file now? Like I said, it's jumping to the master page gallery, converting that into ASPX page. And when I preview my page now, we should hopefully see the changes. Voila. Cool. So hello world, beautiful page layout. And I'll continue this process, adding components, tweaking my layout until I'm happy with both my master pages and my page layouts. And once that's ready to go, I'm going to package it all up in a single WSP, which can then move to another site. So what I'll show you now is just how I'm going to go and import a design package I created earlier. So I'm going to go back to Design Manager, and I'm going to import a previous design package. Okay, so it's really kind of that easy. So this is going to take about 30 seconds for that to upload, and process. So in the meantime, we're going to come back to that in a second, but in the meantime, I'm going to show you how we can set up our managed navigation. Okay, so a new tab will open up the site. And I'm going to go to site settings and then go to the navigation options. Okay, now you'll see this is a pretty familiar looking page if you've played around with 2010. But now under navigation options, I have an additional option checkbox radio button there for managed navigation. So managed navigation is driven by a term set and relies on the managed metadata service and allows me to create hierarchical pages on the fly. And it's pretty neat. So I'm going to go ahead and turn that on. And then I'm going to go ahead and create a couple of dummy pages to illustrate how easy it is for me to change my navigation on the fly. So, add a page. You notice it added straight to the navigation. I'll add another couple as well. And one more after that. And by the way, while that's been processing, our design package is uploaded and successfully installed itself. So now we have a wonderfully branded SharePoint site. It was that easy. So on with the navigation demo. I'll add one more page and a contact us page as well. Every website needs a contact us page. Whoops. Okay, so I've got three pages now. What about if I decided that actually contact us really needs to live below about section? So in 2010, if I was going to use this just out the box, I'd either have to go create manual navigation, or I'd have to potentially have to create a whole other sub-site below this one and move my page across, which would be a big pain. Now, with managed navigation, I can simply go to the term set and rearrange my terms. So let's have a look at that quickly. So I go to site settings, go to term store. Here's my term set I organised earlier. What I'm going to do is just right-click on Contact Us and move it to About. All right. And I'm going to have to do a hard refresh of this page because it gets cached locally to improve performance. So I'm going to Control and F5. And there we go. We've got About Us sitting below our About Us page. And in 2013, we can make that even easier. We've got this fantastic little edit links on our navigation, and I can now just drag my navigation along on the fly, save that, and it'll update my term set for me, which is a big productivity win and makes life a lot easier. So as you can see, I could have a single page library here with hierarchical content, and it's all driven by my term set. Pretty cool. Let's jump back to our slides. Okay, cool. So there we go. So we've seen in that demonstration, we saw how we could brand up a site using Design Manager. We saw how we could also set up an information architecture, create pages, and configure our navigation using managed navigation features. Let's have a look at cross-site publishing and catalogs now. Okay. So firstly, what is cross-site publishing? So in a nutshell, it's getting content from one site collection across to another site collection. Okay, and we do this through the magic of search. So typical installation, you'll have a content site collection where you're generating your content and your content authors create stuff, and a rendering site, which might be a public website, where consumers view that content. You'd have a term store, use the managed metadata service, which you use to tag content in your content site collection and add navigation to your rendering site collection. Typically, you'd also have an asset site collection, which provides images and media to all, to both the other collections as well. And we can use the blob cache to optimize that for users and cache information to improve performance. And then search is kind of where all the magic happens. So search will crawl our content in our content site collection and also our term store to create hierarchical relationships. Our rendering engine then, through a bunch of really cool out-the-box web parts, allow us to write queries to our search index and return information, which also gets cached for the user. So in a nutshell, it's just leveraging search to make content move work for us. Product catalog, on the other hand, again, is a new piece of functionality in 2013. So if you check out Central Admin, you'll see there's a new site template called a product catalog. And this is just an implementation of cross-site publishing. So what you need to do is go set up, if you enable a cross-site publishing feature on a site collection, it gives the ability to add a product list or a catalog list, which you surface in your content site. And then your rendering site, you can consume that using catalog pages and content by search web parts. And I'll show you a demonstration of how we can do this in a second. Okay. So kind of, there's a lot of scenarios that we can actually leverage this in the real world. If you look at most of the Microsoft demos, it kind of focus around e-commerce scenarios. But we can also use it for a plethora of other things as well. So for internet-facing site, you might want to use it for FAQs, or e-commerce, obviously. You can also leverage it for multilingual sites and look at the translation services in 2013. In Intranet, you can use it really for kind of pulling content from multiple web applications into a central location, or authoring content in a central location and pushing out to other areas. Extranet scenarios, you might want to tag internal content in your intranet for public consumption, maybe news and updates, and then roll that up into a single intranet to prevent the users having to edit content in multiple places, multiple times in different places. And the really cool thing about this is that we can manage our permissions and content in a single location, but distribute content all across our farm, which really can increase the productivity for end users. Okay, let's have a look at a demo. Okay. So what I'm going to show you now is a product catalog. So I'm going to set up a list of members for my website in a content site. Notice how this is black, it's a totally separate site collection. And then we're going to surface this through a product catalog in our public website that we created in our first demo. So if we jump into my members list over here, this is just a standard custom list in SharePoint. I've added a unique content type to it, and I've added some ISOM data as well, but nothing too special. All right, let's have a quick look at what an item looks like in here. So if I edit this item, I can see a particular member has a title, which is like a username, he has a picture, he's got a member type. And I'll get you to pay particular attention to this because it's important later in the demo. So a member could either be a developer or a designer or IT pro. It's kind of hierarchical. Okay, and we can drill down into different areas. We've also got some skill sets and a bio and some age information as well. Nothing too special there. On top of that, So that's just a basic list. So what we need to do now is set this up so that other sites can consume this list as a product catalog. So to do that, I'm going to go to my list settings. And you'll see on the bottom, under general settings, I now have a catalog option because I have already enabled the cross-site publishing feature. I'm going to click on that and configure this site. So there's a few things I can do here. Firstly, I can enable it as a product catalog. I can configure anonymous access. So one important thing to remember when you're creating product catalogs is that the permissions for your site, for your content, get stored with the content, not the consuming site. Because this is a public website, I've turned on anonymous access. The catalog item URL field is where I tweak what the URL is, and you'll see how that works in a second. So when someone, that's kind of creating the friendly URLs. And the navigation hierarchy, notice I've chosen member type again, is what will be transferred to my public site and be turned into navigation as well as tagging my content. So if I click OK there, it's going to go through and publish that. Before I can consume their content, though, I need to go run a full search crawl. I've already done that in the background because it takes a couple of minutes, so just take my word for it. So the next step is to now hook that site, that list, up to my public website. So what I want to do now is click on the site settings. Give that a second to load. And there's an option for managing catalog connections. I'm going to connect to a new catalog. And you'll see my members list turn up here, which I've just exposed. I'm going to connect to that. Cool. So now I've got an option to integrate fully or just with my site or not. And I'm going to say yes. I'm going to choose what navigation I'm going to take across to my site as well. So I want to take all members to my site. I'll add those. I include that in the root of my navigation. And then down the bottom here, I'm going to choose which pages to implement this product catalog on. So if I just leave that as is, SharePoint will do some really smart stuff in the background and create me two new page layouts. But I've actually set some up previously and styled them up a little bit. So I'm going to choose those. Okay, now I'm going to click OK, and that's been done. So pretty much, you know, within a few minutes, I've set up a product catalog. If I hover over all members now, you notice my navigation's been updated, and that matches the term set that I showed you previously. If I click on all members, it takes me to my catalog roll-up page, which I've just set. I'll just do a hard refresh on that. Cool. And here we go. We've got our content. So our page's been rolled up. I've pre-populated these with some refiners as well. I'm not going to go into too much detail on that. Probably check out a search session later in the conference. And down the left here, I can drill down into through that hierarchy I set up in my term set as well. So I can look for just developers and maybe back-end developers as well, and filter through on those. I can click on a particular item, and that takes me to a product detail page or a detail page where I can see the person's skills and their bio and other bits and pieces. So in a nutshell, that's product catalogs. I'll show you quickly what the term set looks like as well, because that's worth seeing. So if I go to the term set, cool. So if you check out the catalog demo, what it's done here is it's copied my member types from my consuming site collection, from my content site collection, up into my navigation as well. So that's what's happening behind the scenes, which is pretty cool. Let's jump back to the slides and look at the next feature. Cool. So there we had a look at creating product catalogs, and we also had a look at how we can display that using the Content by Search web part, which was on that roll-up page. Let's look at device compatibility in SharePoint 2013. So before I kind of talk to you about what we can do in 2013, I just want to touch on why it's kind of a good idea that you should be thinking about this. And to help illustrate my point, I've got a few useful factoids I found on the interwebs. So I'll just read these out to you. So over 1.2 billion people access the web from mobile devices. Okay. The global traffic now accounts for 50% of all internet traffic. And no one screen size is more than 20% of the market share, which just goes to show why we need to account for those. And 61% of people have a better opinion of brands when they offer a good mobile experience. And I guarantee you, all those facts are real. I didn't actually make any of those up. But I mean, really, hopefully that helps illustrate kind of why it is important that we consider this. And obviously, Microsoft isn't stupid, right? They can see the writing on the wall. They understand that everything is going mobile. I mean, you just look at their purchases of Nokia, Windows 8 and its touch compatibility, and the Surface device as well. So SharePoint has obviously come along with that as well and is doing a really good job in terms of meeting mobile needs. So out the box, this is the support we have. So all the major browsers are supported in 2013, which is fantastic. It's kind of a heaven send. It even works on iPad and Android tablets as well, which is pretty cool. So I can use Office web apps on my iPad, for example, and have exactly the same experience that I have on IE on my desktop, which is pretty neat. So that's awesome, right? Is that enough, though? I mean, can we just leave it there? Or do we have to put some more consideration into a mobile experience for users? And the answer is yes we do. And there's a couple of reasons for that. Firstly, we need to reduce our page load and make sure that these pages load quickly, okay? And the second one is we need to optimize our user experience. Just because our wonderful response design has squeezed everything onto a single page doesn't mean it's easy to use. People like me with fat fingers, for example, we still struggle. So you're going to have consideration for them. And a point to drill that home is another little factoid from Amazon. So for every 100 milliseconds increase in load time, decreases sales by 1%. And that's in 2006. So I can guarantee that mobile consumers' expectations are definitely going up and not down. So I hate to think what that is nowadays. Okay, so let's have a look at some of the mobile functionality or device support we have in SharePoint 2013. I'm just going to jump back into my demo environment quickly. Okay, so here's our site that we left off last. I'm going to jump into Design Manager. And there's a couple, sorry, not Design Manager, I want to jump into Site Settings actually. And there's a couple of things I'm going to show you now. The first one is Device Channels, and the second one is Image Renditions. So firstly, Device Channels. So device channels effectively allow us to specify a user agent string and associate that with a master page. So we can create a unique experience for particular devices. So what I'm going to do now is quickly create a new channel for a Surface device. So add a new item, give it a name, an alias, which is a code I can refer to it later. And then the inclusion rule over here is attributes in my user agent string. So for those of you that don't know, a user agent is attributes that all web browsers post to a web server when they're requesting a page. And it helps you to know what kind of device is consuming your information. So I know that this is a particular tag that comes through from the Surface. I'm going to turn that to active. Cool. So halfway there. Next thing I need to do is map a particular master page to this device channel. Okay. So if I click on my master page gallery, or master page settings, notice how I now have two options there. My default master page, which I normally have in 2010, but now also an additional one for my device channel. And for my Surface device, I'm going to choose a unique master page I created earlier, which has some slightly different theming to it. And other than that, it's pretty much exactly the same. I'm going to click OK, and I'm done. If someone comes to my site now from a Surface device, they'll be directed to access my site using that master page. And we'll see that in action in a second. Before we see that, though, I want to show you quickly, I want to show you image renditions. So image renditions is, again, new functionality in 2013 that allows us to dynamically and consistently resize images in our site collection. So effectively, it's just a list where we specify the width and height of a particular image. We can then associate that with any image in any of our publishing pages. And what SharePoint will do is dynamically resize those and reformat the image and load it into a cache so that it's really fast for future users. So I'm going to add one for our demo here. We'll give it a width, some arbitrary numbers, and click on save. So now that's available for any page image field on my site. Let's go to a page that I want to optimize specifically for a mobile device. Okay, so with any good site, you need a good reference. So what I'm going to do now is going to edit this page. So what I've done here is I've got a couple of different image fields, one that I'm only going to display for mobile devices and one that I'm only going to display for desktop devices. I've also changed the layout slightly, and which is something you really do need to consider when you're designing for mobile. In this case, I'm kind of putting the text up front so that the user can consume that first and not be distracted by images, which might kind of reduce this strain real estate. So what I want to do here as well, in addition to changing my layout, I want to optimize that page for my mobile device. So I'm going to add a new rendition to that. So if I click on the image page, I can click on the selection over here and click on first thing and choose a image rendition. So this one we just created. And you see that's been resized dynamically. But this doesn't kind of look just right. You know, you're missing my awesome hairdo. So what I want to do now is go and tweak that a little bit. So if I go to image renditions, edit those. Give that a second to run. You'll see these are all the renditions available for this particular image on the site collection. And you see how they work under the hood. It's just a query string appended to the URL with an image with a rendition ID number. And what's really cool about that is that I can dynamically change these on the fly using JavaScript if I wanted to. What I'm going to do now is just tweak my demo image over here. I'm going to change that, and I'm going to move it to kind of focus on a different part of the image. Cool. And I'll go ahead and save that. And then I'll click on OK. Now you'll see a message pop up there saying this image rendition might not change because it's been cached. So I'm just going to do a hard refresh again. Probably should have saved that first, to be honest. Oh, no, that worked. Cool. And there we go. We have our page saved. So just to prove this actually all works, what I'm going to do is open this up in my Surface emulator over here. I'll open an IE. And I'm going to copy my URL across. Who put that there? I can't understand why Microsoft would ship the emulator going straight to Google. This is ridiculous. And voila, you can see the true extent of my visual design skills there. We now have a blue border, which is kind of illustrating them using it. Thanks. We're using a different CSS style sheet. Also, we've got a different layout and we've got different images. So just to have a look back at what the full page looks like, that's exactly the same URL, same page, different rendering. And it's that easy, which is pretty cool. Okay, back to our slides. Cool. So there we had a look at device channels for different devices, so different master pages, and we had a look at image renditions as well for optimizing our content, our images. Now let's have a look at search engine optimization. So we've got this wonderful site, and the world really needs to see it. So I want to make sure that I get my Bing search ratings as high as I can. Cool. So this presentation is not about the in-depth drill down into SEO, but in a high level, these are some of the things that normally increase your search rankings. So the things called sitemaps, which are XML-based files that, that search engines crawl and work out what your pages you have in your site and when last were modified. Metadata about what content's on a particular page, friendly URLs, and incoming links as well, which obviously you don't have much control over. But overall, one thing to point out is that content is still king, okay? So even though we've got all this functionality in 2013 now that's going to help us out, if our content's rubbish, we're still going to get a rubbish ranking. So there's no way of tricking Bing. So let's have a look at kind of what we can do in 2013 that we couldn't do in 2010. So I'm going to jump back to my demo. I'll just reload this page quick. So first things first, I'll show you how we can create a site map. So I've already gone through, I'm going to jump back to site settings here. I've already enabled a new feature called Search Engine Sitemap at my site collection level. And that's unlocked a few cool pieces of the features for me. So I've got two options here, one to optimize my search engine settings and one to tweak my sitemap settings as well. So in my search engine settings, I can add, I can jump into Bing or Google and register my user and my site as a legitimate site, and they'll give you some metadata that you can chuck into your header, and that'll just process through here. You can also set up, and I've got to be careful, because I've been saying colonic URLs the entire time we've been practicing this, but conical URLs. And those are pretty much URLs on your site that might have a query string attached. They effectively are the same page, or maybe different pages. And this way you can configure that to make sure you get the right amount of page hits. From a search engine sitemap perspective, I can add tags that get applied to my entire site. And I can disallow search engines to crawl particular parts. So stuff like my layouts directory, they don't really want search engines crawling your settings pages and stuff like that, even though they shouldn't be exposed to the internet anyways, but just in case. And also your bin directory and catalogs and stuff like that. And once we've configured that and hit save, if we go to our site/robots.txt, it'll display the information over there. And if I follow this URL over here, it'll give me my sitemap. So obviously this isn't particularly interesting to read, but I hear that search engines do love it. Just thinking about it for a second. Cool. So while it's downloading that, I'll show you some how we can also add a special unique content to our sites as well. So if I go back to my home page now, what I want to do now is going to add some keywords to my page and also description to the page, which is a key thing for search engine optimization. So if I go and edit this page, give that a second, click on properties. So you notice that there's a new option here that we never had in 2010 again, namely SEO properties. So what I'm going to do is click on that, and it's going to give me the ability to drill down into some of this information. So firstly, I can set my browser title, so that's what's displayed at the top of the page and rendered on search engines. I can also add a meta description for my page, and this gets added to the header, and it's particularly looked for by search engines. And I'm going to add keywords that will turn up in related searches as well. I can choose whether to include or exclude this page from my sitemap, which will kind of push up rankings up and down as well. So just to prove this is actually working, I'll click on OK. I'll view my page source. And there we go. We've got our meta tags, our description, and our keywords sitting in our host header. The other big plus for search engines in 2013 is our friendly URLs. So notice how this URL has got no ASPX at the end of it, no pages directory, which is pretty cool. Even if I click on the root of my site, no longer do I get the pages/default.aspx, no longer do I get the 302 redirects as well, which is also a pretty big positive. You mean, can you add extra categories in there? No, as far as I know, unless you... Good question, I don't know actually, Wayne. I'll probably have to get back to you on that one. I'd say no. Yeah. I definitely haven't heard anyone trying to do it yet. Cool. So let's jump back to our slide deck. Okay. So there we go. We saw how to create our content, to optimize our site for search engines, how to add metadata tags to pages, how to add information site-wide, and how to create sitemaps as well. One important thing to remember if you're creating the sitemaps is before that'll work, you actually need to extend your web app to include an internet zone, otherwise it won't work. You also need to ensure that you have anonymous access, which kind of makes sense, otherwise a search engine is never going to find your site anyways. Oh, and sorry, and thirdly, you've got to make sure you do a crawl as well. Again, 2013 is very search-centric, so it's kind of a common theme there. All right, guys, so that pretty much wraps up what I want to talk to you about today. So just to recap, we've seen some really cool functionality around 2013. We've seen how we can create a blank site, brand it up really easily using Design Manager. We've seen how we can tweak our navigation using the metadata navigation. We've created product catalogs to pull information using content by search web parts from one site collection to another. We've optimized it for a mobile device, and then we've done some search engine optimization as well. So as you can see, you know, it's pretty productive. That was really easy. We did all that in an hour. It's 2013, I'm personally really enjoying. If you want to play around with some of the stuff yourself, strongly encourage you to go and sign up for a free tenant on 365. It only takes about 5 minutes, and you can play with pretty much everything I've seen today, apart from the content by search web part. You neither can even set up the meta tags in your pages, but you just can't expose that publicly because the public websites and SharePoint 365 is slightly different. But we're not going to go into that right now. Cool. So that's us done for today. Plenty of other really cool speakers on our SharePoint section. So make sure you hang around. Check out Neil this afternoon. and Wayne's got some good session on search as well if you want to do a bit more deep dive into the display templates as well. And on Friday as well, make sure you don't get too hungover. the SharePoint exams are out now as well, so if you're interested in getting certified, make sure you look into that. It's obviously very kind of focused, at least for developers, around app development, which is really cool. And that's pretty much us. So if you want to talk to me later, find me at TechFest on Twitter, or I'll probably hang around after the presentation for a little bit. So feel free to come and grab me. Other than that, always appreciate some feedback. Before we open for questions, make sure you please add your evals. And needless to say, anyone that gives me all fours gets a lifetime free subscription to SharePoint Dating. So get involved. Awesome. So that's about us. We've got a bit of time for questions, I think. And we've got some awesome prizes as well. So best three questions get some real sweet prizes. Any three questions. Who thought that was cool? Who kind of thinks 2013 is a big step up? Yeah. You're in the draw. All right. Yes, you can actually. You can upgrade them and import them as well. Yep. Sure. Yeah, so not some of the search features are restricted. So the content by search web part doesn't exist, unfortunately. Obviously, there's a special kind of public site in SharePoint 365. You don't have all the publishing features, so you can actually implement the SEO side of things, but it's pretty scaled down, so it's not quite ideal. Yeah. Mhm. Yeah.
Now, are you actually changing the code of the master page
in
there, or is it just the CSS?
Oh, yeah, I changed some of the attributes inside the master page as well, added a few placeholders, and uploaded that. And I also attached a CSS file directly to that, just so I can kind of illustrate the change as well. Yeah, absolutely correct, yeah. All right. Right. Yeah, Friday afternoon, yeah. But it's pretty similar to, in a nutshell, it's pretty similar to 2010, apart from you don't have in-place upgrades anymore. So you're kind of rebuilding your farm. Also, there's a lot more hardware requirements as well, but Wayne will cover that off in a bit more detail. All right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you feel like that's gone? Have they nailed it in terms of being able to do what you want?
So it's a lot easier. It's still a CMS, right? And every CMS has got its restrictions. You've got to work with the product. Now there's HTML5, it's a lot cleaner. You're not dealing with like a billion tables all over the place, which is pretty cool. And also the display templates mean that there's a lot more out-the-box functionality you can tweak, so you don't always have to rebuild stuff from scratch. All right. I need somebody who's getting questions. Cool, one more. So yeah, good question actually. So Silverlight's pretty much gone. The only place that I know Silverlight still exists is in the organisation web part, in the my site, and also. So pretty much everything's now HTML5. So even the BI stuff's all HTML5 as well. So you're not really relying on Silverlight, which is pretty cool. All right, and we're good for time. I actually forgot to start my timer. So I've got no idea. Oh, sweet, cool. The back there?
When you do a cross-site publishing,
yep.
You still do a content deployment after you've gone from the author and like the author and the site?
Yes. Yeah, you should be, as long as you're kind of pulling those same page layouts in the same location. So you're not taking the content across, right? You're just surfacing that from the search index anyway. So really that's just your layouts and your look and feel on the public site, yeah. Cool. One more question. Yeah, go on then. Get his phone out, this sounds hard. All right. Yeah.
And you have a catalog in one environment and then put it all into the second. Does one site own that catalog, or is it possible to edit the catalog from both sites?
No, yeah. So the content all lives in one place, right? But you can consume as many site collections as you want. So I was actually staged that across that demo across four different site collections, just all prepackaged. And they were each, all of them consuming the same catalog. So when you edit the information, you're always editing it in the list, in the back end. Yeah. Yeah, yes, it's a larger yes. So again, it's all kind of HTML5 now. The web parts are a lot cleaner. Also, a lot of the search web parts now leverage the design templates as well, which means you can kind of tweak those and make sure it's not clean HTML. There's still some work to be done, right, if you're looking to do some heavy optimization. But out the box, it works pretty well. So if you have a standard site, deploy it, you'll get all that device. If you're doing heavy customization to your master page, then of course you also have to make sure you put through the rigor of making sure you also push it down to the web parts and all the content as well. Well, I'll give you a prize because you've asked heaps of questions, and that's awesome. And then we'll do one more question as well after that. And someone had a question over here about some stuff. No? Oh, there we go. We've got this awesome thing. I don't know what it is, but I really want it, to be honest. all right, best, out of the next three questions, best one gets this thing. All right. Sorry, we'll do you next. Yep, yeah, go for it. Yes. Yep, so you can do. Yeah, absolutely. But that is literally probably the most basic site template. All it's got in there is a publishing site, and it's activated that one feature for you. So it would be hard just to create your own web template based on that if you wanted to. Cool, this one. Yeah. So it's really easy. So actually, the first step in the device in the design manager gives you a little link and just opens up that library in Windows Explorer. So you can absolutely do that in 365. That's not a problem. So it's the same functionality as when you go to any library in SharePoint, click on the ribbon and click on Open in Windows Explorer. With 365, you just got to make sure that you have the client tools installed as well. Otherwise, it's sometimes a little bit buggy. But we branded up exactly the same. And you can take a package from on-premise, put that into the cloud as well, and kind of do it backwards, apart from there's a couple of weird references you've got to remove. Okay, cool. Yep, so it will do. So what happens is in the back end, it actually kicks off a timer service that runs once a day, and you could tweak that to run more regularly. And it works with the search content as well. So you make sure your content is crawled and your site map is updated. So by default, it's updated daily. Cool.
So you have an updating as you're making changes.
Is there a way that the actual optimization process stop that? Yep, so in terms of which component that you mean, to the product catalog? Yeah. Yep, absolutely. So you could have any list could have an approval process on it if you wanted to. I've turned off check-ins and check-outs and publishing on all my lists and libraries for this demonstration. But there's nothing stopping you adding those back in if you wanted to. Cool.
Delete site, does the external, so you kind of reference that sort of make that delete as well?
Cool. So just to get the question correct, so if I delete my public site there, would my content and my catalogue still be around? Is that what you're saying? Yeah, correct. So it's still living in a separate site collection, so it's still going to stay there until you delete that content. And even then, it's going to stay in your crawl until you delete that as well. Cool. I'll, one more question. Yeah, correct. So what you can do is you can set as many different device channels as you want, and you can specify whatever agent strings you want there. So typically a user agent will have, you know, maybe 10 different attributes, and then you can also rank those as well. So you can say if it's got this attribute and that attribute, then do this layout first or this master page first. Yeah. So it's up to you. It's kind of flexible. You can create a million if you wanted to, but be a bit hard to maintain, to be honest. All right. For SharePoint, yeah. Oh, for SharePoint, yeah. So in terms of installing SharePoint, yes, you have to use SQL Server. But if you're looking to use leverage kind of line of business data, you could connect to Oracle or whatever via the business data catalog. But that's probably another separate kettle of fish. Cool. All right. So you asked a question about 365, and I really like 365. So you can have the AttackNet. Oh, very, very jealous. Congratulations. All right. How are we doing for time? Cool. Is that about an hour? Cool. And maybe one last question, and then we'll finish up for today. All right. Cool. Hopefully you guys enjoyed that and learned something along the way. Feel free to come and grab me during the conference if you have any other questions. And thanks a lot for listening. Cheers.